In the previous lecture, we saw the equation for phase modulated and the frequency modulated signal. Now we'll understand these two modulation graphically. At first, we take a carrier signal and a sinusoidal modulating signal. According to the definition of the frequency modulation, the instantaneous frequency, FIT, of the frequency modulated signal is varied in linear proportion with the instantaneous amplitude of the modulating signal MT. Or when the amplitude of the modulating signal increases, then the frequency of the modulating signal continues to increase, and conversely, when the amplitude of the modulating signal decreases, then the frequency of the modulating signal continues to decrease. This means that when the modulating signal MT reaches its positive peak value, then the frequency of the frequency modulated signal hits its maximum. Conversely, when the message signal MT reaches its negative peak value, then the frequency of the frequency modulated signal drops to its minimum. If the amplitude of the modulated signal is equal to zero, then it indicates no variation in the frequency of the frequency modulated signal. The extent to which the carrier frequency deviates from its original value or unmodulated value in the frequency modulation is known as the frequency deviation. To achieve the frequency modulation, this deviation represented by del f is directly proportional to the instantaneous value of the modulating signal MT, and the rate at which the frequency variation takes place is equal to the modulating signal frequency FM. The amplitude of the frequency modulated signal always remains constant. In the phase modulation, the instantaneous angle for phase deviation is varied linearly with the modulating signal. Here, as we can see, the instantaneous angle is varied with respect to the modulating signal MT. For a sinusoidal message signal, changes in the phase are done with respect to the frequency. When the amplitude of the modulating signal is equal to zero, then the phase modulated signal is same as the carrier signal, as the modulating signal goes positive for the points A to B and C to D, the phase deviation will become positive, and due to this, phase modulated wave leads the carrier signal, or we can say that carrier signal lags behind the phase modulated wave. This results in a compression of the carrier signal or an increase in the frequency of the phase modulated wave. Conversely, when the modulating signal becomes negative from B to C, then the phase deviation will be negative, and due to this, the phase modulated wave will lag behind the carrier signal, or we can say that the carrier signal leads the phase modulated wave. This results in the stretching of the carrier signal or a decrease in its frequency in the phase modulated wave. Although waves for frequency modulation and phase modulation look similar, it is important to understand that phase modulation is essentially identical to frequency modulation generated by taking the derivative of the modulating signal MT with respect to time. Consequently, for the phase modulation, we typically plot the derivative of MT, effectively shifting the original modulating signal by 90 degrees. This will be clearer if we take unit step signal as the modulating signal. For the unit step signal, the value of the signal is equal to 1 when the time t is greater than 0. So again, we take the carrier signal, we take the sinusoidal carrier signal and the unit step signal as the modulating signal to see the frequency modulation. And for the frequency modulation, when the time t is less than 0, then the amplitude of the modulating signal MT, which is the unit step signal, is equal to 0. Then the frequency modulated signal is same as the carrier signal. But when the frequency of the frequency modulated signal is same as the carrier signal, when the time t is greater than 0, then the amplitude of the modulating signal is equal to 1. Then the frequency of the frequency modulated signal is increased in accordance with the modulating signal MT. For the phase modulation, when the time t is less than 0, then there is no change in the phase of the modulating signal. When the time t is equal to 0, then the modulating signal goes from 0 to 1, and the phase of the modulated signal also gets reversed. This phase modulation can be plotted by using differentiated version of the modulating signal MT. To see that, let's take a square wave as the modulating signal. A unit amplitude square pulse is a signal that stays at a constant value 1 for a specific duration, then abruptly drops to another constant value for the remaining time. Let's see the frequency modulation for this modulating signal. On the amplitude of the modulating signal stays at 1, then the modulated signal has a high frequency. When it is equal to minus 1, then the modulated signal has a low frequency. Now, in order to plot the phase modulated signal, we will take the derivative of the modulated signal MT. The derivative of a function represents the instantaneous rate of change of that function. In simpler terms, it tells us how much the function's value is changing at any given point. If we apply the derivative to the square pulse, then When the pulse is at constant value of 1, then the derivative is equal to 0 because the value isn't changing. However, at the point where the pulse abruptly changes from 0 to 1 or minus 1 to 0, there is a sudden jump in the value, and this jump is represented by a positive impulse in the derivative. When the pulse changes from 1 to minus 1, then this derivative effectively jumps down from 0 to minus 1, creating a negative impulse. For a complete cycle of the modulating signal from the time t is equal to 0 to the time t is equal to t, it will have two impulses, and this will continue for all the time. So the derivative of a square wave is a train of alternate positive and negative impulses. Here we can understand phase modulation easily, as the modulating signal changes, either creating a positive impulse or a negative impulse, and the phase modulation occurs in the modulated signal. Let's see some of the important properties of the angle modulation. First property is the consistency of the transmitted power for phase and frequency modulated signal. From the previous lecture, we know that the angle modulated signal ST is equal to AC cos 2 pi FCT plus KP MT for phase modulated signal, and ST is equal to AC cos 2 pi FCT K 2 pi KI M tau D tau for the frequency modulated signal. The amplitude of phase modulated and frequency modulated signal is maintained at a constant value equal to the carrier amplitude AC for all the time T. If the signal is transmitted through a wire having a resistance of 1 ohm, then the average transmitted power P average equal to half AC square R, which is equal to half AC square. This power is constant for the angle modulated wave for all the time T. The second property is the non-linearity of the modulation process. Another distinctive property of the angle modulation is its non-linear character, and this is because both frequency modulated and phase modulated signal violates the principle of superposition. Let's say modulating signal MT is made of two parts, MPT and MQT, then we can write MT is equal to MPT plus MQT. Frequency modulated signal produced by this MPT and MQT are ST, SPT and SQT, where ST is equal to AC cos 2 pi FCT plus 2 pi KI integration from 0 to T M tau D tau, which can be replaced by MP tau plus MQ tau, and SQT is equal to AC cos 2 pi 2 FCT plus 2 pi KI integration from 0 to T MQ tau D tau, and SPT is equal to AC cos 2 pi FCT plus 2 pi KI integration from 0 to T MP tau D tau. So we can see that ST is not equal to SPT plus SQT, although MT is equal to MPT plus MQT. So we can say that the angle modulation is non-linear in nature, as it violates the principle of superposition. Bandwidth noise performance trade-off in angle modulation. Angle modulation is less sensitive to the presence of additive noise, but it requires a corresponding increase in the transmission bandwidth of the signal. Angle modulation compared to amplitude modulation offers a better noise performance. This is because when the angle of sinusoidal carrier wave is modulated to transmit a modulating signal, it is less affected by additional noise compared to amplitude modulation, where the amplitude of the carrier wave is modulated. However, this improved noise performance comes with a trade-off. The angle modulation requires a larger transmission bandwidth. In simpler terms, by using angle modulation, you can choose to trade off some of the available bandwidth to get better noise performance. But this trade-off is not possible with the amplitude modulation, as the transmission bandwidth is fixed within a range based on modulation type. Irregular zero crossing behavior of the angle modulation. Zero crossing are defined as the instant at which a waveform changes its amplitude from positive value to a negative value, or the other way around. In general, the zero crossing of a frequency of phase modulated wave has no longer a perfect regularity in their spacing across the time scale. When we let the angle of a wave be influenced by the modulating signal in phase modulation or frequency modulation, then the pattern of zero crossing, where the wave switches from positive to negative, becomes less predictable. In amplitude modulation, these zero crossings are more uniform, but in phase modulation and frequency modulation, they vary more because of the non-linear modulation process. This irregularity in zero crossing is caused by non-linear nature of angle modulation. Comparing phase modulated and frequency modulated waves to angle modulated waves visually demonstrate this difference. There are two special situations when the irregularity of the zero crossing in angle modulation does not occur. First condition is when the modulating signal changes linearly over the time. In this case, the frequency of the phase modulated wave shifts from original carrier frequency to a new constant frequency based on how fast the modulating signal is changing. So this is a ramp signal, and if we take this signal as the modulating signal, then it changes linearly over the time. And if we perform the phase modulation based on this modulating signal, then phase modulated wave will shift to a new constant frequency and the irregularity of zero crossing will not occur. The second condition is when the modulating signal stays constant. If the modulating signal remains at a steady value, either positive or negative, then the frequency of the frequency modulated wave also shifts from original carrier frequency to a new constant frequency depending on the value of the modulating signal. We have seen this in the case of frequency modulation when we used square wave as the modulating signal. When the square wave reached the value of plus 1, then the frequency of the modulated signal was a constant frequency, and when it reached the minus 1, then also the frequency of the modulating signal was also constant. Although the frequency on the modulating signal had the value of plus 1 and minus 1 were not same, but they were constant throughout that instant when the modulating signal had the value plus 1 or minus 1. The final property is difficulty in visualizing the modulating waveform in angle modulation. This property indicates the challenge of visually representing modulating waveform in the angle modulation, specifically in phase modulation. That's why we couldn't differentiate between phase modulated and frequency modulated signal when we took the sinusoidal modulating signal as the input. Unlike in amplitude modulation, where the modulating waveform is clearly seen as the envelope of modulated signal, this isn't the case in angle modulation. In amplitude modulation, the modulation percentage, if less than 100%, allows for a clear depiction of modulating signal. However, in phase modulation and frequency modulation, due to the non-linear nature of angle modulated signals, it becomes difficult to visually discern the shape of modulating waveform in the modulated signal. Therefore, this property highlights the complexity in visualizing the modulating waveform in the angle modulated signal, as the relationship between modulating and the carrier signal is more complex. This concludes our discussion for this lecture. In the event that you have any question regarding this presentation, feel free to post them in the comment section, and don't forget to hit the subscribe button. See you in the next one.